Gunjan has an MBA from Southern Illinois University and a mechanical engineering degree from the Indian Institute of Technology, Kanpur in India. He was also the president of the Alumni Association of the IITs. Based in the New Delhi area in India, Rajneesh Rohatgi spent over 7 years building BD's medical surgical business in South Asia. Rajneesh has over 25 years of marketing, sales, and leadership experience in India and Africa in the healthcare, medical device, and consumer sectors. This includes a stint as VP of marketing for Max Healthcare, a leading hospital chain in North India. Among his key accomplishments at BD was pioneering a customer-centric segmentation strategy followed by tight tactical execution to win against low-cost local competitors. At Max Healthcare, Rajneesh developed one of the first branding strategies for a healthcare provider in a market where the only brand had been the physicians themselves. Rajneesh has an MBA from the Indian Institute of Management, Calcutta, which was established by MIT Sloan School, as well as a bachelor's in metallurgical engineering from IIT Kanpur. So without any further wait, here is Gunjan and Rajneesh.
Well, thank you, Supriya, and welcome to all of you who have joined in on this call today. We are going to go at a fairly rapid pace, and I do encourage you to make this as interactive as possible by sending questions on the chat box so that we can make this relevant to you. We do consider this a web clinic, not just a broadcast, and so the more you're active, the more value you will get out of this. A few months ago, the Chicago Transit System announced that they were buying 400 AEDs, and it was an order placed on cardiac sciences. The interesting thing is that cardiac sciences, which has offices here in Southern California as well as in Seattle, is actually now owned by an Indian company, Opto Circuits, out of Bangalore. And Opto has bought a few other small US medical device companies as well. And the reason I bring this example up is that to highlight the fact that there are many interactions in the medical technology area between the US and India. It's not simply a one-way street where American investors are benefiting from products designed and sold by American companies into India. There is flow in both directions, and we'll talk a little bit about product development in India towards the end of this webinar if we get time. We'll talk primarily, of course, about India as a market. But I encourage you to ask questions about any aspect of medical technology and the interaction with India. Let's go from cardiac sciences to the largest medical device company that is independent, Medtronic. And they launched a program not so long ago called Shruti. This is one of their many, many initiatives in India run by a group based in India. They partnered with a health startup that offers a mobile solution that was developed at MIT, and they partnered with an Indian industrial design firm. The first two deployments of their services are at the Shroff Charity Hospital in New Delhi and at the Health Management Research Institute in Southern India. And the focus in this particular case has to do with ear infections, and you can see they're using essentially a smartphone kind of approach to capture photos of this Indian patient. And the initial focus, I think, was simply on screening the 70,000 patients that are mentioned on this slide. But there's interesting and innovative initiatives happening across the board in India, and American companies, some European companies as well, are at the forefront of this this kind of activity. So I'll tell you briefly about Amritt. Our mission for the purposes of this webinar is really to help medical device companies to leverage emerging economies such as India, and we work with senior management at medtech companies of all sizes to be able to engage with the markets in India either directly or through a channel or other types of partners. We also encourage the chief technology officers and VPs of engineering and enable them to be able to access the technical skills of a country like India or China. We enable them to access technologies and products in these geographies. And you'll see, you heard earlier that we have some fairly wide-ranging clients. We've been featured in many of the medical device publications and conferences, and I won't dwell on that any further other than to tell you that if you like more details on some of the places where we've been featured, we can probably send you slides and presentations. Some of these things are also posted on our website. So really, we're going to talk about selling Western-made products into India, and then also a little bit about using India's engineering skills for Western markets. Let's take a look at what's happening in the medical technology business. And really, one of the goals for many medical technology companies is, how do you go beyond the first billion people that live in Western Europe, North America, Australia, and Japan? How do you go to the next level? And what we like to do is talk about the next 3 billion medical customers. They're characterized by a number of factors. The most visible factor that people tend to focus on is, hey, they have less money to spend. That's true. The patients have less money, the doctors have less money, the hospitals have less money. And this is further exacerbated in a country like India, where insurance hasn't been a major factor in the medical business until recently. But there are other factors that I think mitigate this and modify it that you should be familiar with, or at least have an acquaintance with. One is that at the hospitals and the clinics in India, at the physician's locations, the cost of labor is significantly lower. And therefore, they can do things that may not even be economical or practical in a hospital or clinic in Manhattan or Los Angeles or even in a small town in America, but may be quite practical and doable in a country such as India. Also, I would say that in many cases, American medical device companies factor the cost of product liability and the legal issues and risks related to that as a significant risk factor which raises prices of products in a market such as the US. In India, in general, the risks of this kind are significantly lower. So you can take that into account when you develop a strategy and tactics for India. My colleague Rajneesh has put this very well, that India is a demand-side economy compared to China. And I really like his example of creating airlines in India before the airports are ready, selling millions of cars before the roads are built. And the same kind of thing is happening in the medical technology business as well. So what this leads to in terms of the opportunity in India is you really need to look at not just the immediate next 6 months of opportunity, next 1 year or 2 years, but to reach down and grab the market before other competitors start to get into the lower echelons of the market and rule you out. This has happened in many sectors where American companies wait on the sidelines and then they find themselves limited to a small pond, whereas the big ocean is being farmed by other companies, whether Indian or European or Asian. And that doesn't need to happen. So Indian medtech companies are also getting very smart. Some small startups are doing remarkable things. And while they may be acquisition candidates for you, sometimes if you can be nimble, you can actually stay ahead of them. At the very high level, India is a large country, almost a $2 trillion economy, growing at about 5 to 6%, and we expect that growth rate to edge up with the new government. The healthcare market, however, even at when the economy was growing at 5-6%, has been growing at double-digit rates, and so there is a very substantial upside. The device market in India, according to our research, is still relatively small, about $4 billion as of last year. And the interesting thing is that most of it is controlled by foreign companies, and American companies pay a big part in that. But it's still, you really have to look at the future of the Indian market to see the real value. Most of the expenses, as I mentioned earlier, are paid out of pocket. But insurance is growing very rapidly. Partly at the low end, there's a government-funded insurance program, and partly in corporate India, insurance is becoming a significant factor where the families of the employee are covered by private insurance policies. And so the number you see in 4 years went by sixfold in terms of the Indian population. It's still small, but I expect it, it to get to 20% in reasonable time. The government spends about one and something percent of GDP on healthcare, but even the previous government had decided to double that, and the budget that came out just a few weeks ago from the new government, Prime Minister Narendra Modi's government, has reinforced the idea that healthcare spending by the government will go up. There are issues around slow decision making with government purchases and corruption and FCPA issues that you have to watch for, but there is a market for US companies across the board, whether it's private or a municipal or nonprofit hospital operation. At this point, let me see if I can hand this over to Rajneesh. But before we do that, Supriya, I'd like to start our first poll while I unmute Rajneesh.
Sure. So folks, I'm going to go ahead and put a poll up, and if you can all respond, that would be great. Thank you.
So we see that a little over half of you are keen on India, and a little bit under half on this call are keen on China. It's interesting that the other countries don't figure at all. That's a little bit unusual given the nature of our webinars in the past, but it may just be a reflection of the current mix of the people who have voted. So go ahead and close the poll. And Rajneesh, are you able to? Can you talk and let's see whether we can hear you?
Yes, I've been on the call and I hope that the voice is loud and clear.
Go ahead.
Okay. Did we move ahead one slide extra?
We are on slide 8, recent Indian international medtech entrance.
Okay. So as you can see that we are here, we're trying to give a couple of examples of some of the recent entrants into the medtech market in India. And while some of the large companies globally have entered here in the first wave of liberalization of the Indian economy that happened in the late 90s and mid 90s onwards, but there is a constant stream of the tier 2, tier 3 companies and even a lot of new startups. One example is of a company which is typically focused in European markets, a company out of Sweden. It's in wound care and a lot of consumables like drapes, gowns, masks. It competes with 3M globally and Kimberly-Clark and entered India in 2012 in a market which already had two multinational players like 3M and Kimberly-Clark at the top end and a host of two or three other companies from India itself at prices which are one-third of 3M's prices, which were driving the consumption of these products into their tier 2 and tier 3 markets. And yet they chose to enter. And I think one key factor which this illustrates that it's never too late to enter India because the market is still growing at 15% and you're never locked out even if you have a Me Too product. The second example is of a company which chose to start pretty soon into India within months of its global launch. It's about half a billion dollar company. And within a year or two of succeeding in some of the Western countries, entered India because the nature of their product was ideally suited for some of the unmet needs in the country. And this is around molecular diagnostic blood tests for tuberculosis. It's only recently that India has recognized the threat of MDRT, multi-drug-resistant tuberculosis. And this is really a test which is trying to address that. And they're working very closely with the government. They're working closely with Gates Foundation, which has a very high credibility with the government programs. And they're giving a special price of as low as $10 compared to $16 or $20 plus in the rest of the world. So those are some of the companies which have taken a route of working with the government and not really looking at directly selling into the private market. Yeah, moving on. So Indian market is actually very polarized and has a very heterogeneous mix of hospitals. On the one hand, you have the global class hospitals like Apollo, and these are corporate for-profit chains. They've been featured in Harvard case study. An Indian American cardiologist from US who worked many years there came back and set this up in the 80s. And now there are two or three other such chains. These hospitals are on par with the best that you can find anywhere in the world and offer a similar class of service. This is the kind of market where multinational foreign companies can sell their global products. They don't need customized, made for India, cheaper products for this segment, because this segment of hospitals really caters to the top tier Indians, affluent Indians, as well as a lot of medical tourists which are coming into India for treatment here. At the other end of the spectrum are very low in quality of service, government-run hospitals, which is the public sector. And while the quality of doctors there is supposedly very good, they get inundated by the volumes of patients, which really swamps a lot of the service elements of the hospital. And that really interferes with the quality of delivery. But however, when the system works for them, for example, a prime minister of the country would probably get admitted into one of these top institutes there, run by the government, because the system is then working for him. And that's the kind of caliber of doctors that these government institutions have. But for the common man, often because it's completely free service, it tends to become an issue. So that's the spectrum across. And if you look at it with slightly more granularity in the next slide, so if I look at all the kinds of inpatient facilities which are there in the country, a very large chunk of it is in the private sector. And that may be an anomaly and quite an oddity compared to what you find in many other countries, where both developed countries as well as the emerging markets, where the government tends to be a very large contributor. In India, government has by and large not done its share of work in the last 60, 70 years since independence, and the private sector has stepped in to fill that vacuum. Today, almost 70% of the infrastructure of providers is actually in the private sector. And there are, again, like I said, the three classes of hospitals. One is like the corporate global class top-tier hospitals, which accounts for 5% of the beds only, but are really catering to the kind of Indian who earlier would travel to US or Europe for treatment which is not available in the country 10 years ago. Not only that, they're beginning to attract patients from these very European countries or American countries or Middle East and Africa who come in here as a cheaper alternative to going to US or UK. Then under them are what used to be the best hospitals run by trusts, often charitable in nature or by a religious denomination. And they account for perhaps 15% of the beds, about 500 of them. They range from about 100 beds to 400 bed hospitals. And these two, as you can see, between them account for only 20% of the beds. A vast majority of Indians goes into very, very small hospitals with average bed size of 25 or 30, which accounts for 60% of the beds in the country. And in India, we call them nursing homes. I know it's a very different connotation from the term nursing home in US, but these are really had its origin in a lot of maternity and birthing and nursing facilities, though they have now become the center for all secondary care or elective surgeries and so on. Now that is where this is a huge market of 60% of the beds, which is a classic case of the almost the bottom of the pyramid, individually small but collectively large market. It makes a lot of logistical challenges of how do you reach them and how do you sell to them, but if you can crack that, it's a real opportunity waiting to be tapped. The government sector, like I said, therefore accounts for only 20% of the beds. And again, there's a huge spectrum of hospitals there. On the one hand, there are the teaching research hospitals, which are really very high end of clinical capability among the doctors there. The volumes of patients that they teach, that they see, is a great learning experience for the doctors. The variety of cases that they see in these hospitals, and those doctors tend to be snapped up by the private sector because of the sheer experience that they acquire seeing so many millions of patients. On the outpatient side, there are estimated 1 million plus practitioners. I wouldn't call all of them doctors. They are also including the traditional forms of medicine, whether it's homeopathy or Ayurveda, which is the traditional Indian form of medicine. And finally, there's a new emerging segment of home care solutions, which is for patients to get medical help at home on a chronic basis. So as you can see, you know, to illustrate this whole segmentation with one particular example of, let's say, the intravenous catheters, it's a 300 million unit market with $75 million of sales. And the Western companies which came in the 70s and 80s really pioneered this category, upgrading the market from wing needle sets, which is a declining segment. And these were at 60 cents today, very high quality, standardized, global class products which are available. And they really go and cater to the top tier of the hospitals where the wealthy patients come. And in between these large chunk of people, if you were to just animate, Gunjan. And there is a middle segment between these two extremes of population which is not reached and the wealthy, of what we call the aspirers. And they are willing to spend a certain amount of money, much more than what the wing needle set would cost, but certainly much lower than what the premium Western companies products priced at 60 cents. So there are a huge number of brands which have entered here at about 20 cents. And this category was pioneered by Indian brands who came in after the Western companies had done the concept sell of converting from a wing needle set to the IV catheters. And they really helped diffuse the practice downwards into tier two and tier three markets, because of a huge price advantage of, for a comparable quality product. And it's now even companies like a Vigon from France are beginning to tie up with local manufacturers to launch a second brand of their catheters and create a segment of multinationals, but our Western companies, but at Indian, made for India, made in India kind of a priced product. And that's the opportunity that exists to upgrade a large part of the market, even if you're a relative late entrant. And your global competitors might already be there at the top tier.
And I would add that this insight that Rajneesh is offering is one of the key ways to get high profits in India if you want to go beyond that top upper 15%. It's something to really keep in mind. Clearly, it plays out differently on, you know, with each product category within MedTech. But it's one of our watchwords as we have found guiding American and European companies into India and expanding their business.
What tends to happen is that people assume that you might assume that if you're not in India yet and two or three of your global competitors have been around for 10 years, you might have a feeling that, you know, India is locked out for you because they have a head start of 10 years. However, it's important to note that most companies which enter India tend to spend the first 5 or 10 years of what I call the phase one of their growth, really getting into copy-pasting the global solutions onto Indian top tier, which is the global product at the global price point with a global go-to-market strategy of face-to-face selling with in-servicing, which is okay for the really large top tier hospitals which are catering to affluent patients. So even they, despite being here for 10 years, have not really penetrated into the balance 80% of the market. And that is where, if you can crack on how you can reach there, is you might actually jumpstart in spite of being a late entrant into India.
So Priya, can we run a poll this time? Yeah. Maybe two polls?
No? Sure, I'll go ahead and run another poll. And folks, please continue to send us any questions you might have.
Okay, so it looks like about 25% if you have spent no time in India at all, another 25% have spent less than 30 days, and then about 42% have spent more than 30 days. We use this 30-day measure as really a cutoff point to understand how well you might know India. And it's somewhat arbitrary, but it helps at least focus our attention. So we've got a good chunk of you who are not familiar with India at all and a good chunk of you who are. So we'll again try to address both groups. Today we don't happen to have anybody on the call who lives in India, but we often do. Let me, if you can get rid of the poll screen, Supriya, let's move on to the next slide. Are there any questions before we do that?
Oh, yeah, we do have a question. You can, it might be better answered later, but I'll read it out anyway. It's by Virendra, who's asking if you can please throw some light on the healthcare IT market in India, and is that in sync with the medical device market?
Rajni, should we address that later, you think?
I think so.
Yeah, okay.
All right.
All right. Let's move on. Do you want to take this as your last slide, Rajneesh?
Okay. So we just try to be here in this slide trying to capture the broad categories of scenarios in which a company might be entering India. So if you are coming in with a completely new concept where there are no competitors existing in India, for example, if somebody were to come in with robotic surgery, you won't find anybody really playing in a major way here. And that's where the opportunity would come through, no different from any other country where you would introduce this, which is education and concept sell, and then in servicing and getting a whole set of users to become familiar with how the product has to be used, which is the skill part of using the product. And that's really very similar. India would not require any significant change in your go-to-market strategy. The next category would be there if your product is an existing category, but you're coming with a significant advancement over what has been available. For example, on the same IV catheter example that we were talking of earlier, if you were to come in as the first player to bring in a safety engineered catheter, which is engineered for either patient safety or healthcare worker safety. And you have global competitors. And here you would really, your strategy and opportunity would be both volume and value gain by upgrading from a normal catheter to a conventional catheter, from a conventional to a safety catheter. And the last category would be which oftentimes people might self-censor and say it doesn't make sense. But in India, you might be missing an opportunity, which is if you have a me-too product. And you might say, well, there are already four or five players in the IV catheter market. I have really no major significant plus point or a benefit to talk about against them, and therefore it's too late. However, again, like I said, remember that an experience of a market growing at 15%, a whole set of customers which are coming from traditional forms of medicine to Western medicine for the first time in their lives, at the middle and bottom end of the market, represents a very different dynamics from the stable, mature markets of Europe and North America. And there is a potential to grow with the market and gain your fair share.
Perfect.
Over to you, Kunjan.
Alrighty. So with all of this backdrop, we think that India offers some opportunities that may or may not be available or may not be attractive in other countries. And one of our creative solutions is that you enter India with a traditional distributor, but you limit the distributor's role to essentially physical movement of product, and you combine your marketing ability with a strategic partner based in India who can provide much of the value add that you might see from a distributor in another country, such as India domain experts that you can hire on a partial basis, so you don't have to put them on your payroll full time, but they can provide the translation between your products and the Indian market. Excuse me. And this kind of group can also be responsible for protecting your reputation, which can consist of, you know, your brand, your ethics, your compliance procedures in the rest of the country, in the rest of the world. And also, just as important, the culture of the operation of your business. I think that's a crucial aspect that you want to protect that sometimes gets lost when you go to the low-end Indian distributor. So an approach like this gives you the ability to essentially extend your market outreach, your sales and marketing functions, without having to invest in hiring all of those people early on and trying to retain a small team in a growing market like India. So that's something to keep in mind. For some of you, it may make sense to use such a team to go and do some advocacy, to be able to develop relationships with nonprofits in India, with select governments, and to address the larger issues of both chronic and acute health that are unique to India, issues around tuberculosis, diabetes, malaria, and so on. These are of great interest to the Indian government, and sometimes the local solutions aren't sufficient. And so it's something that you may wish to look at. And again, this is not something that most of you will want to or should do early on. But again, it's something that we can help you evaluate whether it makes sense. As we talk to companies that have become successful in India, this is true in medical technology, but it's also true in other fields, in other sectors, that people often are able to leverage their success into India as a learning experience to go into many other emerging markets across Asia, whether it's Indonesia, whether it's the Middle East, into Africa, into many other places, even sometimes in Latin America. And India becomes a great laboratory to develop solutions that are unique and different from what you might have offered to the first million people in the Western world. A mutual friend of Rajneesh and I has written a book on succeeding in India, and one of his lines is, succeed in India, you can succeed anywhere. So that's something to keep in mind as well. I'm going to change gears at this point, but before I do, let us quickly run the remainder of our polls, Supriya, if you can. Supriya, are you there?
Yes, Gunjan. I'm running it as we speak. We also have a couple of questions, Gunjan, so I don't know if you want to address that now or later.
Yes, let's go ahead and do that.
Okay. So we have a question that has come up from Rakesh, who's asking if you can comment on the percentage of medical device import versus percentage of medical device manufacturing in India for the Indian market.
Yeah. So our numbers seem to indicate that most of the sales of medical devices as opposed to consumables are a result of imports into India. The duties on medical device import for medical purposes are fairly low compared to other sectors, and the capabilities of Indian manufacturing have been limited. This is a moving target. And Rajneesh may have some insight to add to this. What do you say, Rajneesh?
Yeah, I think it varies by sectors, but if I were to take overall part of that $4 billion which you had put up earlier, Gunjan, I would say 2/3 of it would probably by value terms would be imports. There are a large number of manufacturers, but they tend to be in late entrants at a mature phase of the product category when they just really replicate the same design at a much lower cost and push it through the wholesale channels into tier three and really bottom of the pyramid markets. So their value share tends to be low, even though their volume share might be a little higher. And I would say a 2/3, 1/3 ratio between imported to locally manufactured would be a fair estimate.
Great. Any other questions, Supriya?
Let me just go ahead and close this poll first.
Okay, yeah, go ahead. Okay, so the question was, how would you characterize your India efforts at this time? And it looks like the plurality is for people who are still considering the idea. And there's a very even split among the others, people who have limited sales, people who have some degree of success, and people who have already gone ahead and set up a manufacturing facility and or subsidiary. So it's very well distributed, I would say. Can we run the last poll at this time? Do we have one more poll, Supriya?
Yeah, just sure. Hold on just a minute. Yes, I'm going to go ahead. Last poll here.
All right. So while this is happening, we can address the health IT question, or we can let's do that, Rajni. So health IT clearly has a couple of factors to consider. In the U.S., health IT is often driven by federal requirements. Medicare requires electronic billing, and that created a whole industry when Medicare did that. And now with the Affordable Care Act and the electronic medical record push, there was a whole second generation of automation that happened, which created healthcare IT opportunities. In India, the amount of this driven by government initiatives has been fairly limited. It's really been driven by, at the corporate hospital level, really by the need for them to be on par with global initiatives. So they, you know, you can't say that you run a world-class hospital unless you have world-class IT. And so that's been one factor. The second factor that I think that is unique to India is that some of the hospitals in India run at incredible volume compared to the West. And the sheer ability to be able to track a very large number of patients going through on a daily basis, 7 days a week, sometimes, you know, 16, 18 hours a day, requires an IT solution that may have unique characteristics for a country like India. And so we've, you know, from my perspective, those are the two trends that I have seen. The IT solutions can be integrated locally or they can be offered by Western companies. There are some Indian companies offering homegrown solutions as well. Rajneesh, do you want to add to that?
Yeah, I think those two covers the main reasons. And of course, there's a third reason of hospitals wanting to offer patient convenience, also to create a certain degree of repeat lifetime value of a patient of then choosing the same hospital by promising you know, soft storage of their patient records or scans and so on. That's the third reason which a lot of corporate hospitals are doing this. There's one unique kind of health IT which is beginning to take a lot of shape and through pilots and experiments, which is related to telemedicine and to bring access to good doctors into remote areas through telemedicine. And some of it is not just that usual villager coming into a kiosk and there's a routine checkup kind of thing. There is, for example, a pilot with GE is doing with some of the top tier hospitals where remote monitoring of ICU patients using, you know, handhelds with the intensivist gets an alert from a patient which may be 500 kilometers away in another town, which this hospital is trying to provide the same services which they do in Delhi or Bombay. So that's generating its own different kind of connectivity issues and software and hardware.
I'm so glad you brought that up. Yes, I think these are unique and one great opportunities in India to be able to perfect solutions that may not be in great demand in the West, but once they are developed in India, they can be offered in other countries and other geographies as well. So I'm so glad you brought that up, Rajneesh. I hope we've answered the question, because health IT can take many, many forms. I don't know whether he was talking about system integration or software products or billing practices. There's a whole range of things that could be embedded in there, but suffice it to say that there's a substantial opportunity for the health IT infrastructure in India to continue improving across the entire range. It's driven mostly by market pressures rather than by government regulations. Are we back to the slides, Supriya?
No, I just shared the poll, so address that.
Alrighty. So the question was, what is your biggest worry relating to India? And the largest plurality of you are saying that you're worried about charging the price that Indians can afford. And then that's about 42%. And then quarter of you are worried about finding the right business partners or distributors. And I would say that those two are valid concerns. We can generally address the issue of charging the right price by some innovative product and business model ideas, being able to carve out a bigger market than just the upper sliver of the large corporate hospitals, as Rajneesh has indicated. So that's something that we can definitely do. And many have done, there's public information about that. As far as finding the right business partners, I'm so glad to see that a number of you find that to be a significant issue, because often we're just going to start an engagement, Rajneesh and I, with a client who signed up with a distributor some time ago. And so far, the sales have been exactly zero. And now they've come to us and said, hey, you know, we want to do something different. Really, they don't have a lot of leeway with upper management. They can't fail a second time, having failed the first time. So taking the time to find and vet the right distributor instead of a plan that encourages both of you to succeed. Because it's not just finding the right distributor, it's then making sure that they have the incentive to invest the time and effort to make it succeed, I think is crucial. I'm so glad, I'm heartened to see that the audience views that as something important.
Gunjan, if you have a minute, if I can just add something
please.
To that. On both those aspects, I think on the price part, one thing which I've seen a lot of companies benefit from is if they can make the paradigm shift from what works in the US and Europe, which is a scenario where generally volumes don't tend to be price elastic too much. And that's because the markets are highly penetrated for many of the product categories, unless, of course, it's a totally new and revolutionary new product. But and in that paradigm, you don't think of, the companies tend to think too much about the GP percentage, gross profit percent. But if you start thinking as a combination of GP percent as well as GP dollar, and that's where you have a price elasticity that can be pushed. And just putting the same thing which Gunjan said earlier in a different way of carving out a bigger sliver than the top end. And that's where you can generate a lot of profits. Slightly lower GP percentage, but significantly higher GP dollar. And on the distributor part of it, I think it's important to realize that India doesn't yet have evolved distributors who really become a partner. And they're really box pushers, they're multi-brand, they'll be dealing with your competitors. And the reason they've probably taken your brand in addition to what they're selling already is to really use your brand for a margin maximizer. And it's not in their, therefore, interest or objective to push your volume.
Perfect. Thanks very much. So, can we get back to the presentation, or is there another pressing question you think, Supriya, that we should take up right now?
No, I think we're kind of running a little short on time, so I would continue with the presentation at this point.
All right. So I'm going to speed up because not a lot of questions have come up about engineering and product development in India, and the next few slides talk about that, and then there's a slide or two about regulation. So, very quickly, there are technical skills available in India that are being deployed by medical device and medical technology companies. The most prominent of them are the so-called captive engineering centers for the large players, such as General Electric and Philips and Siemens. Entire products have been designed in India for use not only in India and China, but use across the world. One example here is the Lullaby Baby Warmer that was developed in Bangalore, in the Bangalore facility by GE, and is now being sold worldwide. So these are the so-called employees and engineers and scientists working at these facilities have GE or Siemens badges. They're actually working, they're employees of a subsidiary of the Western company. There's another category where there are external engineering service providers, companies that can do part of the design, testing, evaluation, software verification, even some clinical trials and other functions. And these are third parties, typically Indian companies, but some of them are subsidiaries of Western service providers. And this is a huge and growing segment as well. Often we are hired by Western companies to determine the right mix of what they should do in-house in a country like India or China, what they should send to external service providers, and what they should continue to do in the West, regardless of where they are going to sell the product. In all of these examples that I've described, the intellectual property is the patents are still owned by the Western company. So even if you're using an external service provider, you can have an agreement with them that all IP will be owned by you. Sometimes that doesn't make sense, and you can get a better deal by allowing them to own part of the IP, and we can get into that on a one-to-one discussion with anybody if they're interested. But the typical framework is that the IP is owned by the Western company. So often we are asked to evaluate the product initiatives that a medtech company might have, listed here as A, B, C, D, E, and we help them determine which portions should be done in an emerging country, which portions should be done in the West. And this mix varies depending on the project initiative, the maturity of the company, the particular capabilities and skill sets available in China and India, and the risk mitigation factors. So there's not one answer for everybody. But we have found that by picking and choosing and parsing out the work, you can actually get a significant competitive advantage getting products out quickly, reducing the cost of development, making more bets than you could otherwise. It goes on and on. I give a whole separate webinar on this subject a lot. I've got some examples here, and again, I think we'll skip over these for now. They will be in the slide set that we send out to those who request it. There are various ways to engage the technical skills in countries such as India to advantage for you. And that's really what we are talking about in these slides. To present it visually, I think this is a graph that is worth spending a second or two on. On the x-axis, we have the investment in your time and your cost. On the y-axis, we have the ability to leverage the local innovation in a country such as India. And at the bottom left is where you have an agreement with an external service provider. So it requires the least amount of investment in your ongoing overhead in a country such as India, but you also get the least amount of value in terms of harnessing the local innovation and getting the leverage of applying your corporate knowledge to these initiatives. At the other extreme is this so-called captive R&D center, kind that I described earlier in the discussion, where you have employees with your badges working in a country such as India or China. To do that requires time, it requires sending some people from the US or Europe to be able to engage with your India employees, and the ramp time is somewhat slower. But the overall value that you get out of it in the long run is much, much higher. So it's really a matter of balancing that investment. And these are not either or solutions. You can have some work being done externally, some work being done at your captive center. And then there are these other solutions in the middle. Again, I won't dwell on right now, but we find that some of these blended solutions can mitigate the risk and get some of the value of the captive R&D center to our clients. So this brings us to the end of the organized slides. If you want, we can send you a research report on the medical device market in India. It's normally something we sell, but for attendees of the live webinar, we are offering that for a limited time if you simply request it by email. There's also an article about that I wrote along with Professor Vijay Govindarajan of Dartmouth about overcoming pitfalls in India's market. That's broader, not just about medical technology, but I think you would find it of some value. Let me stop there and see if we have more questions to take care of.
Yes, thank you, Gunjan, and we do have some questions that have come in. And folks, again, I would like to encourage you, so this is the last chance to send any questions you might have that can be addressed by Gunjan and Rajneesh. So Gunjan, Kenneth is asking, what type of premium would the aspirers pay for a high-quality product over the cost of the local or Chinese products?
But clearly the answer would vary depending on the product, but I think if we go back to the slide that Rajneesh had, he had some very specific numbers, so I'll let him take that example and then perhaps comment on how it might be different in other sectors, in other categories.
Yeah, okay, I think to take that same example, it depends on whether you're the first person who's trying to upgrade them from what they have been used to at the lower end of the quality, or whether you're trying to come in between the top end players, which is, let's say, in the Ivy Cathedral, we talked about Becton Dickinson and Debron, which were the leading brands here at the top end at 60 cents. And you're trying to come in below them, but above the bottom end of the market. I think that's a big variable which will determine the kind of premium you are able to charge. If you are the first person coming in and trying to upgrade, you could get a significant premium of even double the price at 100% premium or even more. But if that job has already been done by somebody at an even higher price, then you need to go a little lower at a significant discount to them, and that might limit it to, but still a 30-50% premium over the cheaper brands should be eminently feasible. A lot depends on whether your selling strategy it can afford a face-to-face ability to talk to the customer. And explain and justify your premium basis whatever features and benefits. Because the bottom end of the market, really, the large number of customers that get their stocks through the wholesale channel, and there never is a contact point between the company's clinically trained sales team and the end user. So if you're able to create a go-to-market viability for a face-to-face direct selling sales team, then you can explain why your product is more expensive and the value might justify that premium, and then you can get a higher premium. But if you have to ride the channel yourself, then the channel becomes a great equalizer and really throws out a lot of the plus points of your product and says, reduces all conversation down to saying what's the price, and then you will not perhaps get as much of a premium.
Right. I think that's a very important point. And I would also further add that, you know, we are thinking in this discussion so far of India as one, you know, one big homogeneous country. It may make sense, you know, when you are entering India or expanding your role there, to divide up the country either geographically or by subsegment of your market and experiment or evaluate, you know, a couple of different price point strategies. See what might work best. You have to be careful how you do that depending on the nature of the product and whether you're engaging with private or government hospitals, because there are some regulations that also come into play in India, but it's just something to keep in mind. Alrighty, other questions?
Yes, Gunjan. We have a couple more. We have a question from Joanne, who's asking what regulatory approvals are required before we can sell into India.
Yes, and we actually have a slide after the last slide that we had reserved for this relating to regulation. So thank you for bringing the opportunity to bring that up. Can you repeat the question one more time?
Yeah, basically Joanne is asking what regulatory approvals are required before we can sell into India. I guess she's wondering if CE mark is sufficient, or is FDA 510K required? I mean, just in general, a question about regulatory approvals.
So we'll limit this answer to a fairly high level. If you're a Western company entering India, it always helps to have an approval from CE or the US FDA, or perhaps the Australian or Japanese regulatory authorities. That
or CE mark.
Or which one?
CE mark for Europe.
The CE mark, yes. The CE is probably the most common that we see. That's why we have pictures of the US FDA and the CE mark at the top. The way it works in India is you know, by Western standards, perhaps a little bit primitive, because the medical devices are still regulated by the drug authority. This is going to change soon. There is a bill in Parliament that didn't make it through, but probably will, relating to creating a separate medical device regulatory regime. But for now, the same people who regulate drugs and pharmaceuticals are regulating medical devices. They have a list of notified categories, which is fairly limited. And within those, they have a reasonably well-defined procedure. It takes about a year to get through. There are the categories outside of this, it's a little bit gray. Some people say, hey, there's no regulation, so I can do whatever I want. Some other Western companies have a more conservative attitude. So this is something we would really need to discuss on a one-on-one basis to see what might be the right approach for you, depending on the timing and the fact this new law is expected. Typically, this is handled by the Ministry of Health, but depending on the nature of your product, the ministry, the department that handles electronics, and the Ministry of Chemicals may also have some degree of a role. I hope that answers the question at an initial level. If you have a further follow-on, perhaps we can take that offline.
Thank you, Gunjan. And we are sort of towards the end of our webinar, so I'm going to just, we have time for one more question. I think this is sort of addressed to Rajneesh or Gunjan. Do clinicians have the major say in determining the selection of brands, or is the procurement function determining the choice of brand?
Okay. Gunjan, is it okay if I take that?
Go ahead, please.
Okay. I think that's a very interesting question, because things are beginning to change, and change in a manner which is not perhaps conducive to the interests of the device seller. Till now, the user was the chooser. And that's the same which was globally true for the last 40, 50 years. And that's the same model which companies adopted in India all this time, which is you go with a sales team which has been trained to become almost like a doctor or a nurse in their narrow area of the product, stand in front of the doctor or the nurse or the clinician using it, demonstrate the product, give the various clinical studies behind it, convince the clinician, do the in-servicing and get the skill building up. And then the clinician approves it, and you go with that approval to the purchase and negotiate the price. The interesting part in this dynamic was that the purchase guy knew, and you knew that he knew that he cannot deny your product after the clinician has asked for it. So the negotiation was within a certain restricted sphere where he wanted to extract his face-saving discount, and the company knew that, yeah, as long as you get that discount, you'll get your product in. Increasingly in the top end of the hospitals, the corporate chains, which are for-profit chains, which are running this like any other business proposition, the procurement function is getting more and more empowered by the top management to drive better negotiation and tighter negotiation. And you're beginning to see the split between the chooser and the user, the way you would have in government tenders, where the user department only puts down the specs of a product, and then the procurement really decides the brand which gets selected. And increasingly the importance of price and L1, as we call it here in the tender, is becoming relevant even in the top tier hospitals. That is requiring...
L1 being the lowest bidder.
L1 being the lowest bid. And that terminology is restricted to the government tenders, but the dynamic is becoming very similar. So for example, in my previous company, in just around the time I was leaving about a year back, my sales team's biggest challenge in these top hospitals was that the top clinicians would keep telling our sales team, hey, look, I'm convinced about, let's say, the safety catheter, and I want to do it, but the procurement is not letting the product in into the formulary. So stop coming to me again and again with the same story and go and talk to the procurement guys. And companies like most device companies have not really invested enough in finding the right solutions to address this emerging problem. There has been no data, or very few companies have good data on health economics to justify your prices to the procurement guy. There's very limited tools. With FCPA compliances, you don't have the old systems of leaving things to the distributor are no longer acceptable. And there isn't a legitimate, ethically compliant relationship program with the procurement departments in place, like most companies have with clinicians. So there is a big vacuum in terms of what the best of the device companies have today to address this trend. Having said it, the trend is only at the very top tier hospital, which accounts for 5% of the beds, but that's where these hospitals act as the referral hospitals to really set the tone of your product's popularity to cascade down the pyramid.
Perfect. Thanks very much, Rajneesh. And folks who are on the webinar right now should know that it is about 1:06 a.m. in India, so Rajneesh has been very kind to participate at such an ungodly hour with us, but that's the price of doing business globally, and we really appreciate everybody being on. Supriya, it's all yours.
Thank you, Gunjan, and thank you again, Rajneesh, for giving us all your input and insights at the middle of the night to your time. We hope, and I want to thank everybody for attending the webinar today and for being a very interactive audience. We hope it was informative for you. If you have any additional questions, please do email us at usa@amrit.com, and the speakers will answer your questions. As you exit the webinar, please do answer a brief survey that is presented to you. We would really appreciate your feedback. If you have any friends or colleagues who you think might benefit from a similar webinar, do have them register on our website, www.amrit.com, and we will notify them of any upcoming webinars. Thank you very much for attending today, and have a nice day. Goodbye.